The scripture this morning is from Mark 1, verses 16 through 21, and we'll be using the New Living Translation. One day Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee. He saw Simon and his brother Andrew throwing a net into the water, for they were fishing for a living. Jesus called out to them, "Come, follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people." And they left their nets and at once and followed him. A little further up the shore, Jesus saw his sons, James and John, in a boat preparing their nets. He called to them. At once they also followed him, leaving their father, Zebedee, in the boat with the hired men. Jesus and his companions went to the town of Capernaum. Where the Sabbath day came, he went into the synagogue and began to teach.
Pressure this morning. You know, Jerry Seinfeld once said that they took a poll to ask people what their worst fears were, and they said their top fear was public speaking, and they put that above death. So that means at a funeral, you'd be better off to be in the casket than you would be in the picture. Anyway, you know, our scripture today is about Jesus calling the first four disciples, Simon Peter, Andrew, and the brothers James and John. Now, I always wondered for years how come these guys were just willing to get up, leave what they were doing, and follow Jesus. They just dropped what they were doing. The King James Version says it straight away. They went straight away. And I wondered, gosh, would I do that if a strange man came by and said, you know, come go with me? No, Frank, I wouldn't do that. But if Jesus came by and I didn't know him, would I go straight away with him? Well, probably not. But most Bible scholars feel that Jesus had probably been preaching in that area for some time. And so that these four disciples probably knew who Jesus was ahead of time. And by the time he went and called them to be fishers of people, they were ready to go with him. They were ready to go with him because Jesus had a purpose for them. Now, anybody know who Yogi Berra is?
Yeah.
Now, Yogi was a very famous catcher for the New York Yankees, my team. Anyway, not only was he known for being a great catcher, he was also known for what they call Yogi-isms. These were little phrases that he came up with. For example, I like to take a 2-hour nap between 1 and 4. Or, you know, a nickel ain't worth a dime anymore. Or my personal favorite, when you come to a fork in the road, take it. And you know, that day, the disciples came to that fork in the road, and they took it. They followed Jesus, because Jesus had a purpose for them. And when they got up that morning, they probably thought it was going to be an ordinary day for them, just an average day. Get up before dawn, have a little breakfast, maybe some figs, nuts, fried fish, no Pop-Tarts and Cheerios back then, and then off to a boat. Well, fishing in that day was very hard work. Heavy boats, no fiberglass boats, but very heavy, flat-bottom boats. And the nets were extremely heavy. Big, round nets with weights around the edges. And what they would do is throw the net off the back of the boat, and then as they trolled along, pulled the net, and the nets themselves were very heavy, so you can imagine how heavy they were when they were full of fish. One thing we can assume then about these guys is that they were not wimps. They were probably pretty big, strong guys, and they needed to be for what they were going to be going through. Now, the dictionary defines a disciple as someone who assists in and accepts in spreading the doctrine of another person. And that's exactly what these disciples were doing. They were called to assist Jesus in spreading the gospel and to be of service to other people. How about today? Well, I believe that God is calling us the same way today, and that He has a purpose for us today, for each and every one of us. And the scriptures tell us in many places that very thing. Ephesians 1:11 says this: "In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of Him who accomplishes all things according to His counsel and will." 1 Timothy says, "Relying on the power of God who saved us and called us for the holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose." Romans 8:28. Most of you know Romans 8:28. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to His purpose. And in 1 Corinthians, Paul tells us, "Let there be no division in the church, rather be of one mind, united in thought and in purpose." Now notice that one word that keeps cropping up in all those scriptures, and that word is purpose. Many years ago, Rick Warren wrote a very famous book, a best-selling book entitled Purpose-Driven Life. And he went on to write other purpose books, The Purpose-Driven Church. But in his first book, he tells us that all of us have a purpose in life, purpose that God has given us, and it's our obligation to fulfill that purpose for the glory of God. Back in the Old Testament, they had a lot of rules and regulations about how they had to live their life. They even had regulations on what kind of fabric they could, what kind of yarn it would take to weave their clothing, what they could eat, what they couldn't eat, how many steps they could take on the Sabbath day, lots of rules and regulations. But Jesus kind of stripped that down and gave us the cliff notes on Christianity. He made it very easy for us when He said that we just need to do three things. Love God, number one. Number two, love your neighbor. And number three, the last thing He said before He left the earth was, to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Now, any fishermen in the house today? I am not a fisherman, but when I moved down here to Florida, my husband had a bass tracker and he would go out fishing. So I know for a fact that when you go out fishing, you get ready to go fishing. You get your tackle box out, get your rod, get your reel out, you got your lures, your bait, maybe you have a net, you make a few sandwiches, and then you have a nice cooler full of refreshing beverage to take with you. Get out there on the lake, the sun is shining on you, the breeze is blowing, you've dropped your line in the water. You are so comfortable now, you don't even care whether you catch any fish. You are just chilling in the boat, right? Unfortunately, that is what happens with us through our Christianity sometimes. We are chilling in the boat. We've become comfortable in our Christianity. Hey, we're saved. We accepted Jesus as our Savior a long time ago. We're good with God, right? We're going to heaven. We're good people. loving God, loving your neighbor, and then preaching the gospel. There are several ministers out there, preachers that are out there, that have cast really wide nets. I'm talking about people like Billy Graham, Rick Warren, Joel Osteen. These guys have cast big, wide nets with their ministries on television, books that they've written too. Now, God hasn't called us all to do that. He hasn't called us all to cast out a big, wide net like that. But He has called each and every one of us to drop a line in the water and wait to see how God blesses that. Now, are we all called to be preachers? No. 1 Corinthians says that one of us plants and one of us waters, but both of us are working for the same purpose. God has given each and every one of you in this room a unique gift or talent to be used for that purpose, whether it be preaching or teaching or administration. That's not one of mine. Generosity, perhaps, hospitality, joy, enthusiasm, those are all gifts from God. If you're watching Dancing with the Stars, which there's a young woman on there this year. Her name is Bindi Irwin, and Bindi is Steve Irwin's daughter, who was the crocodile hunter. And Bindi Irwin is so full of the joy and enthusiasm that I just have to watch her, and I watch her dance, and just watching her talk and interacting with the fellow dancers on that show gives me a great deal of pleasure. I feel happy when I look at her. That is a gift that she has from God. I heard a wonderful story. Last week, I went to the Methodist Charge Conference, and a woman named Pastor Heather Harding spoke at that conference. And she gave a beautiful little story about gifts. And I told her that I was going to steal that story and use it today. And she said she didn't mind at all. But she told a story about her granddaughter who was having her first birthday, 1 year old. And the whole family was there at that birthday party. And even though that child was only a year old, she seemed to have a knack for opening her gifts, her little bags, gift bags with the tissue in it. She would pull the tissue out, pull the gift out. And each and every gift was so perfect for her. Whether it was a little book, or a little toy, or a little article of clothing, everything was just absolutely perfect for her. That's the way it is with God and us. God has given each and every one of us a unique gift or a unique talent. And He has meant for us to use that gift or talent for Him, not for our own glory. Some people have the gift of music. God wants them to use that gift of music for Him and not for their own edification. You may have received a gift a long time ago, and you opened it up, and you started using that gift. And you've been using that gift all along, and God bless you if you're one of those people. Or you might be somebody who hasn't opened their gift yet. Maybe you don't know what it is yet, or maybe you've only just taken the tissue paper out and not even looked at the gift inside yet. I encourage you to keep looking. Or maybe you're someone who opened up your gift a long time ago, took it out, and used it, and then put it aside. And you haven't used it for a long time. God is encouraging you to take that gift again and to begin using it again for His purposes. He wants you to use all your gifts intentionally. Now, when I say intentionally, I don't mean like the kind of intention where you say, oh, I intend to go to the gym today. There's a difference. Remember, years ago, there was a trend to do random acts of kindness. And what you were supposed to do is, perhaps you were at Starbucks, in line at Starbucks, getting your coffee, and you would tell the cashier that you wanted to pay for the person behind you. That would be considered a random act of kindness. But I say that God never meant for you to do any random acts of kindness. God wants you to be intentional in your acts. God wants you to get up in the morning and intentionally ask Him to take you and use your gift to be used for Him. Anybody heard the story about the guy who went ice fishing? He went out on the ice. He drilled a hole in the ice. He dropped his line down there. He sat on a little stool, waited for a fish. He heard a voice from above say, "There are no fish down there." So he picked up his stool and he moved a little further on down the ice, drilled a hole, sat down on the stool, dropped the line in. When he heard that voice again, "There are no fish down there." Well, this happened several times till he's all the way at the end of the ice. When finally he looks up and he says, "God, is that you?" And he hears the big booming voice say, "No, it's the rink manager." Talk about fishing in the wrong place. But where did Jesus fish? Where did he go fishing for people? Well, he went fishing for people everywhere. He went fishing, talking to prostitutes, to murderers. He went to talk to sinners of all types. Years ago, there was a minister named Bob Harrington, and he was down in New Orleans, and he made a practice of going down on Bourbon Street and going into bars and bordellos and places like that and preaching the gospel to those people. And so he got the nickname Chaplain of Bourbon Street. Now, is God calling you to do that? You know, do that kind of ministry? Probably not. Probably not. But He is calling you to go to Walmart. And when you're standing in line and see that that poor cashier is frustrated, He is calling you to say a kind word to her using your gift of joy and happiness. He is calling you when you're in the doctor's office sitting next to someone else who is anxious to use your gift of to help calm that person. He's calling you when you go to your exercise class to use the gift that you have there to talk to a young mother who's anxious. He's giving you everyday opportunities to go fishing. Now, in order to go fishing for people, you need to be prepared. Many of you, especially if you're in sales, have heard about the 30-second elevator speech. Now, the 30-second elevator speech is simply, you've taken your product, whatever it is, and if you were in an elevator with someone, went from the first floor to the 10th floor, perhaps, you only had 30 seconds to talk to them, you could sell your product to them. So years ago, I came up with my kind of elevator speech. And maybe it's 45 seconds. Maybe it's more than 30 seconds. But this is my story. Many years ago, I was talking with another person, and we were talking about heaven and hell. And I said that when I died and I went to heaven, I thought I would go in front of God and He would have the scales of justice. And that He would put all the good stuff I did here and all the bad stuff I did here. And whichever was heavier, that would determine whether I went to heaven or hell. That other person said to me, "My goodness, you're missing the entire point of Christianity. Jesus died for you so that you wouldn't have to go through that. You will receive mercy from God, not justice from God. Your belief in Jesus is what saves you, not the good or the bad that you've done." And I won't tell you who that person is, even though he is in the room and I am married to him. I'm just telling you that God is asking you to be prepared. When you have done acts of kindness to people, intentional acts of kindness to people, this gives you an opportunity to share the gospel with them. They're going to want to know what makes you the way you are. And that is your opportunity to share the gospel. So do be prepared to share it. And I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to challenge you to ask God tomorrow to intentionally place somebody in your path that you can use your special gift on to minister to them and give you the opportunity to share the gospel with them. You be the bait that lures them to Jesus. You get them hooked. You tell them what God's done for you. In closing, I'd just like to say that God doesn't want you to be chilling in the back of the boat. He gave you a gift, and he wants you to intentionally use that gift. And sometimes when you're using those gifts, you might think they're just little minnows in a pond. But you better watch out. Because when you use that gift and talent that you have, God might just dump you into the ocean to tackle the whale. Will you pray with me? Father God, we thank you that you have a unique and special gift that you give it to each and every one of us. And Lord, I pray that each and every one of us will unwrap that gift and use it for your glory. Help us to be fishers